Good day, everybody. Connor McIver. I wanted to supplement a broadcast today. I'm going to be talking about the real estate community here in Santa Clarita Valley and a conference call, basically a Zoom meeting that I had participated in earlier today. We are closing out this particular week. We're on the 17th day of April 2020, and this is your Santa Clarita and greater beyond real estate update. Now, recently, a lot of our clients that actually own homes, they are very interested in trying to get their payments relieved, at least for a little while. And a lot of them have had success. Some of the things that I will throw out there that are kind of Captain Obvious things, but a lot of people haven't thought about it. When it comes time in the future to start either repaying these amounts that have been forgiven or making up for the monthly payments, a couple different ways it could happen, right? They might come into it. They might say, you know what, Jack, go ahead and give us the last 3 months of payments we've ignored. We want a lump sum. Send it all to us. If not, we're going to proceed with foreclosure problems. Well, what a mess that would be. I can't imagine them doing this, but something to consider. The other thing, too, is we have to talk about loan modifications as well, because the loan happens to be modified. Once they say, okay, Connor, you don't need to make your next month's payment, now all of a sudden Connor's home loan is now modified. How are they going to make that real? There probably wasn't enough forethought to put into the current terms or the title of the property language that states if there happens to be some kind of a pandemic, then we're able to modify these particular systems and delay payments, change payments, increase payments dates, lessen payment dates, whatever it may be. I doubt the language is in there. So it has to be inserted where if my termination date for my particular loan was basically in 2060 in April, let's make it easy, January of 2060, now all of a sudden it's not that date anymore. Now it's 3 months later because the bank has told me, hey, Connor, we'll forgive you for 3 months. That needs to be made as part of my loan now. Because if they try to go and they try to evict or they try to do other things beforehand, let's say I never recover, then all of a sudden I'm going to be able to go to court and say, well, that's not the terms of the agreement as it states. You see what the problem. Those things, those loan modifications, the documentation, the paperwork, they all require, potentially they're going to require recording. That being the case, all that stuff costs money. So while the banks are seemingly very helpful at this time, and I hope they remain this way, and I hope at the end they work it out, and I hope another concern is the algorithmic changes within the banking platform, and I'll talk about that in just a moment. But when it does come to an end, what terms are going to have to be modified, and what is that going to cost, and who's going to incur that debt? Who's going to have to pay that? That's something to consider. Now, going back to the algorithm, the bank's program, whenever at a bank, let's say I'm working for Bank of America or Wells Fargo or Chase or any of the big ones, I don't sit there in front of a computer. There's no branch of the bank that really has to do with late payment monitoring. When it gets to a certain point, sure, human beings now put their eyes on it. Probably right before a notice of default is to be filed, whatever that calendar timeframe looks like. Probably 90 days, maybe. Once a notice of default starts to need to be filed, then a human being probably looks at it. But prior to that, talking about just regular run-of-the-mill garden variety mortgage payments, usually a human being probably doesn't put their eyes on that process until maybe after the first 30-day late or 40-day late. But up until that point, if you're making your payments routinely, you've called the bank and they've given you an extension, I have a feeling that they're probably not going to modify that entire computer algorithm or the computer program that then sends out these notices. Number one, you get hit with that late payment penalty after a particular time of the month. If your payment's due on the first, depending on your bank, it could be anywhere from the second all the way, you know, to halfway to maybe closer to 30 days into it. But at the end of the day, they're going to be reporting that, and it's not because there's an active human being that's pushing the button each time somebody comes in and they're late on their mortgage payment. It's a computer algorithm, folks. It's a program that's in place at the bank that's making this decision. If one equals X and we don't have one, any ones entered in the machine, then the machine is now going to send a notice. So you're going to incur the late payment penalty. And after that first 30 days, if they don't change the algorithm, which I don't know if they can, they can include a new code in there that basically states if you've taken part and parcel, or you've made yourself available or been approved for this loan forbearance or this delay program with the bank, that you're going to be one of those excluded from incurring any late fees and also reporting to the credit bureaus. I don't think that's going to happen. This is all so fresh. You're going to see after this, if you're out there and you're wanting to sell your house in order to buy another one, it's probably going to take a little bit of time after the market starts to recover and the world starts to go back to a little bit of the normalcy that we had before. It's probably going to take a little while to get all these kinks worked out. It's probably going to equate to hours and hours on the telephone. It's probably going to equate to you needing to step up your argument besides a person answering the phone to maybe somebody in the management level of the bank. All these things are going to have an impact. The other thing as well, let me kind of throw this little bit more wood on the fire here. If you happen to be a person that's renting or leasing, you know, the foreclosure timeframes have also changed quite a bit. So that's good for you, depending on who the landlord is and who their bank is. But the courts are having difficult times and they're overloaded with seeing people. So these dates and stuff for you probably going to be extended far in the future. If you happen to be somebody that wants to buy a residence, you need to be wary because those landlords have the power to make on you and say that, you know, this person hasn't made the mortgage payments, thereby hurting your credit. So if you have some kind of a special agreement with your landlord, you need to make sure that's followed up in writing. But if you are making your payments to your landlord, all that's well and good. But now you have a lack of income as far as your job goes because you are one of those non-essential workers, as everybody states are out there and about. So now you don't have any pay coming in. After it's all over, you go to try to resume that home buying experience that you had before the pandemic or the quarantine was announced, before when you were actually gainfully fully employed. Now all of a sudden you have nothing. Now they're going to ask for paycheck stubs. How is that going to work? Are they going to be looking at your pay when you didn't have any? Well, that wouldn't make any sense. So then are they going to back it up and say, okay, we're going to have an exclusion in here for everybody that was deemed non-essential? We're going to go ahead and allow them to use their previous paycheck stubs and then maybe scribe a letter stating that they were in a particular way or they were impacted directly by the coronavirus, COVID-19. So how is that going to work out? In addition to that, some of the other items, we talked about credit reports as well. That goes with those people out there that don't even own real estate, that have made other agreements with other creditors to maybe not have to make as much on their payment, or for an example, maybe delaying payments on particular credit cards. How is that reporting going to work also? Is that going to damage your credit when it comes time to buy residential real estate? These are all the parts of the process. I know it's a little early, but I want to throw it out there. So maybe if you are behind the curve, you haven't made the phone calls yet, but you're starting to get a little concerned, you're going to start making these phone calls to different creditors or even your mortgage holders if you happen to be an owner of real estate, then you might be able to ask further inquiries into these questions, and maybe they'll be able to direct you to a URL or location within their website where they explain clear and concisely exactly how they're going to deal with these things come the future. Also, refinancing in the future, if interest rates stay low, which I imagine they will for this year with this mess going on, that being the case, and if you are a homeowner that hasn't refied yet, or if interest rates come down even further, which would be tough to do, but if they did, you want to do that refi, make sure you having this agreement with your bank, forbearance or whatever, not making any payments for a while, isn't going to reflect negatively on you if you want to do a refinance here as we get later on into the year. Currently, real estate is very slow. There are houses that are being shown. It's going to depend on where you live, what the local governmental agencies are allowing in Los Angeles, at least as of today, they're not allowing any properties being seen. That city, where in the county, which is in Santa Clarita Valley, which is the county of Los Angeles, they are allowing homes to be shown, but they're allowing those homes to be shown in a particular way. Face mask, gloves up, sellers being notified, sellers vacating the property. Then you have the other end of it. If somebody does see a house that they actually like in person, how does the inspections work? And usually the people also vacate for those. The inspectors glove up. They look at the house. In their particular entity, they have to touch things. They can't just walk through as an appraiser might and not touch anything, just walk through the house and look through it and then give their appraisal report later. An actual home inspector needs to touch items, needs to go through the residence, something else that it's going to delay that particular process. But there are still home inspectors that are out there. The other thing are the listings that happen to be owner-occupied. They're taking a little bit more time to get approved for the showing. They're taking more disclosure, more information, more signed pieces of paper, which is something that we didn't have before when we were showing residential real estate. Now those signed pieces of paper have to do with this particular virus and the liability, lessening the liability for all parties, basically signing documents stating that we know we're adults, we know what going into this property could mean, we know that even though the seller states, and they signed it too, they're unaware of being exposed to this virus. It does take a while, and we don't know until after an incubation period whether or not the person actually has it. A lot of changes in real estate. We're closing out here April. This is the 17th of April. We're going to be getting into May. Those numbers between the time the quarantine was announced, tracking back to either 9th, 10th, or 11th of March, I'm taking the 10th. A lot of different news or a lot of information online as far as what that particular quarantine date was when it was originally implemented. Taking that through, we don't have that sold data for a typical escrow time frame, which is 45 to 60 days. I want to see that data. Also, yesterday I put up a blog post at santaclaritahomeexperts.com/blog, which was spectacular until I went to pull the properties that had experienced going from being active status into escrow. And there's two different statuses that match that. But last year they changed one of the conditions and the name of it within the MLS. So I'm getting zero data for my year ago inquiry. So I have questions out and I have a couple voicemails and a couple emails to the Board of Realtors finding out where that data actually is, how I would access it, or if it's been deleted. Because the name in the multiple listing service, as far as how I would search for that data, changed last year. So I'm seeing current numbers of properties going into escrow, which aren't very many because we have the holiday slowdown, then we have the pandemic announced. But I wanted to try to get a yearly comparison from a year before and even before that to find out how far off skew the coronavirus has taken us. I'm Connor McIver. When you're ready, real estate tip of the day, never, ever, 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 lots of evers, give up your personal private information anywhere. Not an open house, not at new housing, especially not at new housing. Don't tell them who you are. They're going to be clever, right? You're going to walk in, they're going to hand you that iPad or that tablet or hand you this card on a clipboard with a pen. Say, hey, if you don't mind, you know, the owner, or the seller, the builder, we would just love it if you leave your personal information. And then you can go through this door over here and go see the models. Don't fall for it. Once you do that, without having your representative with you, you give up your right to have a representative besides the new home builder's agent. I guarantee, if I'm your representative in new housing, I'll save you money, period. Representing you in real estate, I will save you money. But can't sign anything, folks. You can't give up your name, personal information, if you go it without me. But I always recommend to all my clients, let's set it up together. It'll be a new housing tour. It'll be special. It'll be fun. We'll all mask up and we'll go. We'll go in separate cars. I'll stay away from you. Maybe we'll talk on the phone. It'll be awesome. Anyway, I'll be there for you. And also new housing, got to give them credit. They are working with us. You call me, you say, listen, Connor, I want to buy up there at Skyline. When I buy up there at Toll Brothers, I want to buy some other new house somewhere. As stated before, I guarantee I save you money. They are working with us allowing us to do telephonic registrations for our clients. So it's simple. You call me on my cell, say, listen, Connor, I'm interested in going up and looking at Skyline. And I'm able to represent you just with a phone call up to their staff saying, listen, John and Jane Doe, they're going to be in there. They're my clients. Please register under Connor McIver at Remax, Santa Clarita HomeExperts.com. Boom, they're in. And then you and I can have that discussion about the how I'm going to save you money and how that's going to work and when you're going to get paid and so on. Connor McIver, be safe. When you're ready, I'm here. Thanks for listening to our radio show broadcast closing out April, the week of April 17th. It is Friday. Be safe. Connor McIver, over and out.